The drug thalidomide caused what some call the biggest man-made disaster apart from war. You might already know that although its structure looks simple and innocent, a chiral carbon gives rise to two enantiomers with different pharmacological effects. While one isomer was a safe sedative, the other one led to limb malformations in thousands of babies. We will check out how this works exactly, but the enantiomers interconvert in the body, so there's no way to control them. Get this, despite increasing doubts of its safety, the US distributor of this horror drug aggressively pushed for its approval, simply to maximize sales over Christmas. If you think the heartbreaking tragedy sealed thalidomide's fate, you couldn't be more wrong. Half a century later, it generated up to $500 million in sales for a pharma company. Wait, what's this? Oh, just the eye-watering $12 billion, which a slightly modified, much more expensive version of thalidomide brought in recently. How is it possible that the same drug which inflicted so much damage was revived and even influenced one of the biggest acquisitions in pharma history? As we will see, the answer is glue, no joke. The story, of course, wouldn't be complete without classic big pharma monopoly games and price hiking. And let's not forget everyone's favorites, lawsuits. Keep watching to learn the history, biology, organic chemistry, and pharmacology of thalidomide and its many cousins. This will also be a tale of the paradoxical nature of drug development. Let's get into it. Thalidomide has a very simple chemical structure. In the 1950s, the relatively small and inexperienced pharmaceutical company Chemie Grünenthal looked for new antibiotics. Instead of antibiotic activity, thalidomide seemed to be a great sedative and help with sleep or nausea. Unfortunately, it doesn't help our story that some of Grünenthal's leaders were ex-Nazi scientists. The research head Mückter was involved in death camp experiments, but still made bank during his tenure. It started all rosy. Initial safety tests in mice and rats showed good tolerability and no side effects, even at remarkably high doses. Back then, you didn't have to understand how drugs worked at all, so thalidomide was dubbed completely safe and aggressively marketed in 1957. It became Germany's second best-selling pharmaceutical, just behind Bayer's aspirin. Ironically, safety was one of its key marketing messages. Many pregnant women used thalidomide for morning sickness. The lack of its toxicity was convenient, as unlike barbiturates, this agent couldn't be misused for suicide attempts. However, over the next 2 years, sudden increases in cases of usually rare limb defects were detected in many newborns. It's less known that there were pretty early findings of teratogenicity and neurotoxicity from various researchers. Some of them, like these observations on tadpoles, were shared with Grünenthal already in 1958, with no response. Because the incidence of deformations increased so unprecedentedly, German pediatricians suspected an environmental factor. In late 1961, the issues were traced back to thalidomide use by mothers during early pregnancy. Only later did we find out that deformations were actually just the tip of the iceberg. Thalidomide induced many more miscarriages and less obvious defects like organ problems. After increasing noise on the issue, the German government pulled the drug off the market against the company's wishes. The adverse impact of early use is so high that even a single tablet was enough to induce pregnancy loss or abnormalities. But why? To understand, we need to get smart on two topics. First, we need to know about the ubiquitin proteasome system, basically cellular garbage management. Some of you might remember this process from your biochemistry classes. It starts with very few so-called E1 enzymes, which are activated with ubiquitin, a small regulatory protein consisting of roughly 80 amino acids. This green ubiquitin tag is ultimately what directs the degradation of target proteins. As you can imagine, there are thousands of different proteins that the cell might want to be able to degrade. However, it would be challenging to do this specifically if all you have are a few different E1 enzymes. This is why ubiquitin groups are cascaded to a broader variety of E2 conjugation enzymes, which finally put the tag on more than 1,000 so-called E3 ligases. These enzymes recognize specific substrates, and upon addition of enough ubiquitin tags, their targets are shredded into smaller peptides at the proteasome. Second, we need to know about molecular glues. These work exactly how you would think. The glue molecules bind between two different proteins, aggregating or gluing them together. This can have several effects, but targeted protein degradation is the most important one. How does this relate to thalidomide? Well, the molecule binds the protein cereblon, which is part of the E3 ubiquitin ligase complex. Once bound, it can act as a glue between cereblon and neosubstrates, so innocent molecules. This exposes these to the E3 ligase machinery, so they are ubiquitinylated and degraded. Remember that the adhesion arises from nuanced interactions between functional groups of the molecular glue, cereblon in purple, and its neosubstrate in green. We don't know the natural targets of cereblon, but amongst others, it's critical for brain development, hence its name. If you want a more detailed video on molecular glues, let me know in a comment. By acting via cereblon, thalidomide-initiated protein degradation influences the body's immune system. That's why it's also called an immunomodulatory drug. The mechanism is very complex, but one of the innocent casualties is SAL4. This is an important transcription factor that governs gene expression for normal limb development. Its absence results in deformations, which is why thalidomide proved so dangerous for pregnant women. Actually, genetic deletion of SAL4 replicates a similar phenotype, confirming the hypothesis. But why was this missed by Grünenthal? A critical piece of information that was not known in the 1950s, rodents are resistant to thalidomide's teratogenicity. This explains the absence of safety signals even at high doses. Only later did people figure out that rabbits or chickens are more sensitive animal models. But why? The susceptibility comes from a single amino acid difference across cereblon sequences. Primates and rabbits with a valine suffer thalidomide embryopathies, while rodents with an isoleucine did not show any safety signals. Interestingly, the bush baby bears an isoleucine and is the only known resistant primate. Scientists demonstrated that mutant mice with an unnatural valine at the position become sensitive again. Compared to wild-type mice, they showed statistically significant higher miscarriage rates. This is really fascinating. A slightly bulkier amino acid influences binding and degradation of substrates such as CK1-alpha, but potentially also SAL4 or others. If you had a chemistry class or two, you would know that by having one chiral center, thalidomide has two enantiomers. Much too late, it turned out that the S enantiomer is tenfold more potent as a protein degrader. Giving only the safe isomer as a drug is not an option. The acidic proton at the chiral center triggers partial conversion to the bad enantiomer at pH levels over 6. If you've watched my deuterium video, you might not be surprised that this interconversion can be slowed by exchanging the proton for a deuterium due to the kinetic isotope effect. How can the almost identical R enantiomer be safe? Although it has the same molecular contacts with cereblon, its affinity is much lower due to an energetically unfavorable conformation that it needs to adopt upon binding. This twisting occurs because the glutaramide ring wants to minimize steric clashing with the binding pocket, particularly the highlighted tryptophan 383. If we look at its synthesis, it becomes obvious why original thalidomide is a racemic mixture. The Grünenthal route starts with a condensation of L-glutamic acid and phthalic anhydride. Even though the amino acid used was chiral, the basic conditions and high temperature result in a racemic product due to isomerization. To close the ring, the free acids were linked via activation with acetic anhydride, and the last treatment with urea introduced the nitrogen. Before we continue, I wanted to thank all my amazing Patreon and YouTube members who continue to support my work. If you enjoy this type of content, please like, subscribe and share. Let me know if you would like videos on lessons from other major drug scandals as well. The aftermath of thalidomide entailed a large criminal trial examining potential negligent behavior by leading Grünenthal employees. The process was extremely drawn out, probably the dream of every lawyer. 6,000 pages of documents without any clear verdict. Ultimately, it was said that based on the state of science at the time, the teratogenic effects of thalidomide could not have been anticipated, so the trial was terminated and settled between Grünenthal and impacted parents. The company is still providing support to affected individuals through a novel foundation with more than 100 million euros contributed to date. The impact in the US is another ridiculous story. Grünenthal had offered the company Smith, Kline & French, today's GSK, to market the drug in North America. SKF ran a large clinical trial which likely also resulted in several phocomelia cases, and they declined Grünenthal's partnership offer. However, another company, Richardson Merrill, was eager to introduce it. These guys were calling up the FDA to submit a marketing authorization application in the fall of 1960. I really invite you to read this nice article, which contains comments of Kelsey, who reviewed the application at the FDA. And yes, that's her with President John F. Kennedy getting a medal for distinguished federal civilian service. You see, as if this story couldn't get worse and more capitalistic, Richardson Merrill was pushing for an early approval prior to Christmas to maximize their sales. In a now recognized as heroic move, Kelsey challenged the drug's data. Something felt off about giving enormous amounts without any toxicity. So suspicions rose that other conditions could change the drug's absorption and unveil toxic effects. Her suspicions proved to be right, but that didn't prevent Richardson Merrill from giving away literal millions of thalidomide tablets for so-called investigational use, at the time permissible under existing regulations. The FDA cited 17 children born in America with thalidomide-associated deformities, but the true number is surely higher. What has science learned from this tragedy? On one hand, drug controls got stricter. Prior to 1962, drug developers only had to show that new drugs were safe. And as we just saw, even that was not a given. A new pivotal amendment required strict proof of efficacy from well-controlled studies, not the bro science which Richardson Merrill tried to pass. Drug advertising was also now required to disclose accurate information about side effects, and clinical trials had to include informed consent of participants prior to enrollment. For us in the 21st century, this seems obvious. The FDA also launched a comprehensive assessment of drugs that were already on the market. Finally, drug testing got more robust, with a requirement to use rabbits and other thalidomide-sensitive species for teratogenicity testing. Thalidomide's risks, but also benefits, didn't go away. Just shortly after its initial withdrawal, it proved efficacious in ENL, a leprosy complication. To avoid teratogenicity, access to the drug should be restricted with so-called risk evaluation and mitigation strategies, short REMS. For instance, female patients must avoid pregnancy through regular testing and use of two or more forms of reliable contraception. In the US, where thalidomide was approved for leprosy in 1998, this is well regulated. However, use over the previous decades in countries like Brazil with subpar REMS has still led to some cases of embryopathies. Although there was research on thalidomide in cancer already in the 60s as well, the molecule was finally proven to have anti-cancer activity only in the 90s. This time around, the company Celgene got intellectual property rights to the drug and thoroughly interrogated its potential. A landmark trial showcased its value in multiple myeloma, a type of blood cancer. Given its unique mechanism and profile, combination with other agents was pretty powerful. This resurrected thalidomide, turning a monster drug into a precious option for patients who relapsed or did not respond to other treatment. Mechanistically, the anti-oncology effects arise from degradation of Ikaros and Aiolos. Unlike SAL4, these transcription factors regulate the development of B and T cells of the immune system. Ultimately, this inhibits the process of angiogenesis. As a very smart person, you will realize that lower growth of new blood vessels in turn suppresses tumor growth. The new early days of thalidomide remained controversial, with a whistleblower lawsuit accusing Celgene of off-label marketing. Allegedly, they actively pushed thalidomide, which as we saw was approved for leprosy, to be off-label prescribed to cancer patients prior to its approval. While these off-label prescriptions extended thousands of lives, intentional off-label marketing by companies is not compliant. They ultimately had to settle the lawsuit for $280 million. Thalidomide's legacy is even more shocking. We already know that small changes have big impacts. You see, two simple functional group modifications created lenalidomide. This is the big boy. By the way, there's even another hybrid between the two, a bit less imaginative. Due to the new structures, these analogs enjoyed new intellectual property with great commercial success. Lenalidomide received an orphan drug designation, an FDA incentive that gives drug developers special tax benefits and market exclusivity. With a hefty six-figure price tag, the drug earned Celgene double-digit billions in yearly sales. Lenalidomide didn't sell for no reason. It wasn't just a copycat. Molecularly, it is much more potent than thalidomide across various metrics. For instance, its IC50 inhibitory value against resistant multiple myeloma cells is orders of magnitude lower. These molecular changes also translate into better survival outcomes for patients compared to thalidomide. In addition, risks of neuropathies and other adverse events were lower. This is a follow-on strategy gone well, a new molecule with better efficacy and financial reward. You could argue that given Celgene's research is not associated with Grünenthal's initial wrongdoings, they really changed the world for the better. Some may also call it a perverse twist. A horror drug ended up as the basis for massive profits. Some have even accused Celgene of using particularly fierce ways of preventing entry of generics. Doing so, they managed to command soaring prices for the drugs and even continuously increase them. This includes more than a dozen of patents on their REMS system, which further blocked generic competition. Remember, REMS are the special activities that patients, providers, and distributors need to take to prevent harm from teratogenicity. In this case, it means that access to the drug is dependent on several criteria, such as regular pregnancy tests and surveys. This is great because it encourages safe use of the medicine by patients, but as always, we have more potential illegal activities looming. For many years, Celgene fought it out with a generics manufacturer. You see, to approve a generic medicine, the FDA needs to see bioequivalence data. Essentially, we want to undoubtedly prove that the copy has the same effects as the originator. So, generic manufacturers need to buy the branded drug. Allegedly, Celgene not only refused to sell the drugs directly, but they also implemented distribution restrictions that prevented indirect purchasing of thalidomide and lenalidomide. This was resolved after 5 years in classic fashion by paying $100 million and some change to settle the claims. As alluded to, Celgene subsequently was acquired by BMS and with it the knowledge on thalidomide and friends. If you thought this was the end of the saga, think again. The development of next generation cereblon modulators such as iberdomide is still ongoing. At a first glance, this one might look like a simple copycat molecule again. As you can see from this crystal structure, the morpholino side chain extends into a pocket on cereblon, increasing surface interactions and enhancing binding of the molecular glue. This affinity results in a faster protein degradation of neosubstrates and anti-proliferative activity against multiple myeloma cell lines. In normal cells, iberdomide is much more potent. Compare the red and green curves. But more importantly, this analog retains activity in cells that are resistant to lenalidomide. Due to this higher penetration, the hope is that the drug will prove more efficacious in resistant cases. It's currently in phase 3 trials, and again, the idea is combining it with other medications to stack up their effects. We will close with a final next generation idea. Scientists have noted that there's a histidine residue close to the molecular glue binding site. Do you already know where this is heading? By creating analogs with electrophilic groups such as the highly reactive fluorosulfate, we can trigger a covalent bond formation with the proximal histidine. Why is this even interesting? Well, the covalent modification triggers broader conformational changes which change or modulate cereblon's activity. The scientists have found that this covalent modulator led to the degradation of the so far elusive protein NTAC1. Thus, such experiments might unlock even more avenues for drug discovery in different tumor types in the future. To not overdo it, we will wrap up here. Please let me know if you liked it, and thanks so much again for watching and supporting the channel. As always, until next time.